A very good morning to our honorable guest and industry leader, startups, entrepreneurs, and dear students. I'm taking the opportunity to welcome all of you to the session on angel investment for the startups, organized by Bangladesh Venture Capital Limited, Bangladesh Angels, and Department of Innovation and Entrepreneurship. We are doing this program in the celebration of Global Entrepreneurship Week. IBVT Akhtar is highly delighted to be the master of ceremony of today's auspicious occasion.
আজকে এখানে যারা এসেছেন অত্যন্ত গুরুত্বপূর্ণ কারণ এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টমেন্ট নিয়ে কথা হবে। প্রত্যেকের স্বপ্ন আছে উদ্যোক্তা হওয়ার। আমি বিশ্বাস করি এটা হয় আজকে না হয় আগামী কাল। কিন্তু উদ্যোক্তা হওয়ার স্বপ্ন সবারই আছে আর উদ্যোক্তা যারই স্বপ্ন থাকে তিনি একটি আইডিয়া নিয়ে ডেফিনেটলি সামনের দিকে এগোন। সো এই আইডিয়ার জন্য এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টমেন্ট ইজ ভেরি ইম্পর্টেন্ট, বিশেষ করে এই শব্দটি। এবং আজকে ভাইভার্স এই এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টমেন্ট নিয়ে কথা বলবেন। আজকে ভাইভার্স কথা বলবেন এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টারদের কীভাবে আপনারা আকৃষ্ট করবেন আপনাদের আইডিয়া নিয়ে। তা আমি মনে করি যে ভেরি ভেরি ইম্পর্টেন্ট সেশন, আজকের দিনটা অত্যন্ত গুরুত্বপূর্ণ। সারা পৃথিবী ঘুরছেন মিস্টার ভাইভার্স এবং সারা পৃথিবী ঘুরে উনি এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টমেন্টের জন্য কাজ করছেন। আমরা অত্যন্ত আনন্দিত যে আমাদের চেয়ারম্যান ডক্টর মোহাম্মদ সবুর খান, হি ইজ দি হাই কমিশনার, বাংলাদেশের হাই কমিশনার ফর ওয়ার্ল্ড বিজনেস এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টমেন্ট ফোরাম, এবং তার আমন্ত্রণে আজকে ভাইভার্স ইজ হিয়ার। এবং ভাইভার্স আজকে এসেছেন আমাদের সম্মানিত চেয়ারম্যান সাহেবের অনুরোধে, এবং উনি আজকে বাংলাদেশের তরুণদের জন্য উন্মুক্ত করে দেবেন এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টমেন্টের এই চ্যাপ্টারটি। সো হোয়াট আই সেড টু দেম, ভাইভার্স দে ওয়ান্ট টু নো অ্যাবাউট এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টমেন্ট অ্যান্ড হাউ টু ইমপ্রেস দি এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টমেন্ট, অ্যান্ড আই হোপ ফ্রম হিজ স্পিচ ইউ উইল বি এবল টু আন্ডারস্ট্যান্ড হাউ ইউ উইল মুভ ইয়োর আইডিয়া উইথ দি এঞ্জেল ইনভেস্টার্স। Wish you all the best and hope the session will be fruitful.
Now, the moment we are going to hear from Mr. Bhaivarsh Altuntas. Now, I would like to invite Mr. Bhaivarsh Altuntas.
Our main subject is angel investment today. But after seeing that there are so many entrepreneurs in the room, I think it will be good. However, we don't have the time restriction, I think. So I can start how I became an entrepreneur. Just to give you an idea about an entrepreneurial story of a university student, because I think most of you are students at the university now. I was studying at the university in 1987. Yes, I was 17 years old, and in Turkey we have an exam for studying at the university. And we were making 18 choices. The first, my first preference was the tourism schools, but I couldn't make it. And I came to the fourth preference, which was teaching English department of the Faculty of Education of Boğaziçi University. And because the school was a little bit far, then I applied for staying at the dorm of the university. Then I started living in the dorm of the university. And the dorm was in the garden of our Faculty of Education. And I was working in a travel agent to make pocket money. I was giving private lessons. Maths lesson, German lesson, English lesson, and I was also organizing small tours for school children. I was very busy. I mean, school, travel agent, tours, the English lessons, etc. So one day, on Sundays, families were not taking English lessons, maths lessons for their sons and daughters until afternoon, because Sunday is the time for them to become at the round table in the morning and getting breakfast, etc. So until 2 p.m. I was free on Sundays. What I was doing, I was going to the library on Sundays because newspaper magazines were all free and I was checking what is happening. In the library of the university, it was opened 7 days. I took a magazine on a Sunday morning. The article was about franchising. Do you know what franchising is? But in 1991, I didn't know what franchising was. I was 21 years old. I was studying at the teaching English department, and I didn't know the meaning of franchising. I just wanted to understand. I read the article, what the meaning of franchising was. So I read it. But when I read it, I understood there was a great opportunity. Why? Because McDonald's, is there McDonald's here in Bangladesh? McDonald's had just come in 1991 to Istanbul. And everybody was chatting because Istanbul is a kebab city. Turkey is a kebab. Did you hear kebab? Turkish kebab, meat. Everybody was talking McDonald's wouldn't be successful in Turkey because Turkey is the kebab country. So they will go back to the States. So I wanted to understand how the system was working. Then I saw that McDonald's is not opening its branch by himself. McDonald's is giving a license to a local entrepreneur and they are opening the store. They are making a franchising agreement. I said by myself, it is very interesting because in Turkey, there is an kebab brand, Iskender Kebab. It is very famous in Turkey, but in order to eat Iskender Kebab, you have to drive 3 hours from Istanbul and go to there because there is no office of Iskender Kebab in Istanbul. But McDonald's is bringing the store, cheeseburger, from 5,000 miles away to Istanbul, and it is just 500 meters away. I said there is something wrong here from our side. I think someone has to start the branding movement in Turkey, and we have to learn how McDonald's is doing it, and we can export our brands to the world because there is Turkish kebab, there is Turkish delight, there is Turkish hamam, there is Turkish, there are many products, but we don't have brand. For example, when you said Turkish coffee, everybody in the world knows Turkish coffee is very famous. But then if I ask you now, what is the brand? Which brand do you like? No answer. But if I ask you American coffee, you will say Starbucks, for example. Gloria jeans, for example, isn't it? So this branding is something different than the product. Then in the article, there was a, can we close it? Only that one. Maybe we can make it. Or I no. Oh, it is fine. I will speak here. It is done. Okay. There is no problem. And in the article, there was only the fax number because we had fax. Do you know what fax is? My daughter doesn't know what fax is. In 1987, my generation is very lucky. In 1987, I started working in a travel agent. We were selling flight tickets. I was 17 years old at the high school. When I started, there was telex, 1987. 3 months later, fax machine came. I remember my boss at the travel agent. We were sending fax, and he didn't believe it is exactly going same to other side. So we were calling and reading everything to other side if it is the same or not. 2 months passed, he agreed that it is the same thing going. So that was facts. In 1991, internet came. 1991. So I saw telex, fax, internet. But now new generation only knows internet. No telex, no fax. So I sent a fax message to German Franchise Association because their telephone number and fax number was in the article. And I said, there are many Turkish people living in Germany. There is a Turkish diaspora. And why don't we make a branding movement from Turkey to Germany and globalize the Turkish brands? Because this true franchising. This franchising system is very new in Turkey. It can be something interesting for entrepreneurs too. The critical question is, I'm a university student. I'm not from the business administration department. And I'm staying at the dorm and I don't have any money to host this guy in Istanbul. But I believed my idea very much. I thought there was a great need for such kind of a movement in Turkey. So, because I was believing my idea, I didn't hesitate to send this fax message to German Franchise Association. I didn't expect a response, by the way. I only felt I had to send this fax and make my responsibility, because the idea was very correct. 1 week later, response came. Mr. Altuntaş, we received your fax message. It is very interesting. Our president wants to visit Turkey, and can you organize a press conference for him? That was the answer. And I said immediately, of course I can. Why I said immediately, of course I can organize this conference and press conference? Because I didn't know how to make it. If you know something very well, how to make it, you think about it. If you don't know how to make it, you don't think. You take all risks because you don't know which risks are available. And you immediately say, if someone is doing it, I can do it too. I don't know what like a psychology this is, but this is the, I think, real motivation of entrepreneurship. Because in entrepreneurship, if you start thinking so much and see all the risks, then it is very difficult to take a step. In the world, you cannot see so many professors who are the owners of big holdings. They are not. And most of the big holdings owners are coming from a high school level, and some of them left the university, even the Bill Gates, etc. If you read the life story. Why? Because as much as you get education, the left side of your brain is developing. And when the left side of the brain is the center of maths, analyzing, synthesis, etc. And when it develops so much, you see all the risks. So when you see all risks, it is very difficult to. It is better to give advice. So professors are generally good advisors, but they don't take the risk. Thousands of books, etc. And left brain is developing so much. Right side is the center of imagination. You are dreaming. You want to implement what you dream. So left side is a little bit stop and think. This is do it center. So we have to balance, of course, both of them. Because if you cannot balance, then you don't become an entrepreneur. You became a gambling player. This is also very dangerous. Then the next day, the VP of the hotel called. It is because this Kempinski is in an Ottoman palace. First time a palace was converted to a hotel by the Bosphorus. It is the best hotel now in Europe because the only hotel you can stay in a palace. And they said, we want to promote our hotel to the media, and we want to welcome also the economy journals of media. So we want to become the sponsor of this press conference. I asked, what does it mean, sponsor? Because I didn't hear sponsorship word until that time. They said, you organize it and you are not going to pay anything. We are going to host it. I said, this is good. But how much you will charge if you wouldn't sponsor? They say this amount. I loved it very much because I sent a message to German Franchise Association and I said, that is the cost. And I made it for my country. I wanted to bring foreign currency to my country, foreign direct investment, not for my pockets. Sorry, that was my real intention. And Hans Lang was the name of this president, and he came to Istanbul. I took a bus from the school and went to the airport. And at the airport, I was waiting with his name tag, like a transfer guy. And I said, Mr. Lang, please, let's get on the taxi. And he said, I'm waiting for Mr. Altuntaş. I say, it is me. But I gave the answer in the taxi, not outside, because I saw his face changed. Because he was waiting for a businessman, waiting for him at the airport, and we are going to... This was the advantage of my time. There was no Google. If there was Google, most probably he would not come to Istanbul. Because when he Googled my name, he would find nothing in the in the Google. And as a matter of fact, after I saw his face is changing, I said by myself, it was a good decision to take him to the taxi. There were around 70 journalists joining. There was a great demand. And they showed a great demand. I don't know if it was for franchising concept or they wanted to have a nice breakfast by the Bosphorus at the church. I don't know. But whatever the reason, the room was full. And the president of the association was very happy. And the meeting started. In the meeting, he was speaking in English. Unfortunately, in Turkey, still English is a problem. It is very difficult to find people speaking in English. And also the journalists, there were only two or three journalists speaking English, others only Turkish. So he was speaking in English. I was making translation. And the journalist who understands what he says was correcting my mistakes. He was speaking, translation, correction. Speaking, correct. I said, sorry, but this is what I can do. I'm a student at the university and I'm not a professional translator. And I am from the another department of the I didn't say teaching English department. Because they would say you are studying at the teaching English and you don't know the words in English. This is all. Sorry, but please make the translation direct. This media loved me very much. Because I was honest and telling them that I was a student, etc. The next morning, all newspapers, German Franchise Association president was in Turkey, and Baybars Altuntaş, by the way, nobody asked my title. Nobody asked why I was organizing this, why I was there. Nobody asked me. I just said I'm a student. Nobody cared I was a student or not. But they said Baybars Altuntaş is initiating the globalization of Turkish brands movement. in cooperation with German Franchise Association. When I read the articles at the dorm, I was very excited and afraid, a little bit scared of what is going on, because I made an organization and it was a good experience for me. But now the things are going to something to another destination. And I started to feeling that, I mean, people started to perceive me as the expert of franchising. As a matter of fact, I didn't know anything except this two-page article and what we spoke in the press conference about franchising. Then entrepreneurs who read these articles started calling me through the travel agent. Around 200 entrepreneurs. They said they want to open McDonald's. One of them wants to open Benetton. The other one wants to sell their brands to Germany, to other countries, etc. And my travel agent became the center of franchising. Our travel agent was only concerning with the historical tours. Now it is in a different story. I sent another fax message to Hans Lang. I said, there is a great demand from media and from the entrepreneurs. And what is going to happen now? Because they are asking me many questions about franchising, and we have to give a response to these people. He said, this is great. Now please, take two journalists with you. We have a franchise summit in Germany, in Wiesbaden, in May, next month. And please come to Germany and you organize a round table about the opportunities in Turkey, and you also become a panel discussion speaker and you deliver a speech about the franchising industry and opportunities of Turkey. I said, am I going to do it? Yes, you can do it. I said, okay, it is fine, of course. I was sure people would be very happy to hear my ideas about franchising in Germany. And I said, who is going to pay for the flight ticket, etc.? Because I was a poor student at the university. He said, okay, we are going to compensate it, but also two journalists come as three people and we make it happen. I was very happy because it was my first trip to abroad. Until that time, I was not abroad. And it was 1991. I was 21 years old. And with two journalists and me, we had been to Wiesbaden, this panel discussion, etc. There was a great demand to this idea of the Turkish kebab, Turkish lokum, Turkish coffee issue. And the journalists asked me, what is the next step? The next step is, now I am founding the Turkish Franchise Association. She asked me, who are the founders? Me, I said. But by law, we need 7 founders minimum to make it a legal entity. This is the case, because I didn't know the law. And these are 7 people. I gave immediately name. And the next week, in the economy page, Turkish Franchise Association is being established. And here's the list of the founders. All my friends staying in the same room in the dorm are in the founders list. So, because these are the people I know only in the who can accept my invitation to become the founders of the Franchise Association. The only problem is they didn't know what franchise. One of them was studying at the chemistry department. The other one is in another department. But 45 people called me. And they said, we want to become the founder of this association too. These are the real fish. I said, now it is done. Because one of them was the CEO of McDonald's Turkey. The other one is the 7-Eleven. They are the real franchise companies. And they read the article and they say they want to become the founder of this association. Then I decided to make another organization at the Çırağan Kempinski again. But in the second time they charged, of course, for the coffee, etc. And I invited these 45 people. The problem was, one of them is coming in the room and they all, hello Mustafa. The other one is coming, hello. Everybody knows everybody. Except I am organizing the event, but I know nobody. They know me because my picture was in the newspaper, but I didn't know who they were. Then the meeting started. We were sitting in a square table. I said, let's give an opportunity to everybody to introduce themselves so we can know each other. The problem is everybody knows everybody, but I want to know who is who. They started one by one telling who they are. But the one who is sitting exactly there didn't tell his name, didn't give any information about his company. Everybody knew him and he said, I am here because this franchising idea is very good. Franchise association will be very important for Turkish economy. And if there is any contribution, we can do it. Professor also is giving very importance in her lessons. Professor is her, his wife. His wife was a professor of business administration at the Boğaziçi University in Istanbul. And he was calling his wife as professor. And professor also gives importance to this issue in his in her lessons, etc. Then in this meeting, this businessman was elected as the president of the association. And I was elected as the secretary general. Board member and secretary general. The only student board member of any franchise association in the world, I think it was in Turkey. And vice president gave an office area, which he doesn't use, in downtown of Istanbul. So in the afternoons, I had now new job. I was going to this office, secretary as the secretary general of the Turkish Franchise Association. Media was calling. Every week we were making many news about the brands coming to Turkey and brands going from Turkey to abroad, etc. And we were making our round, our board meetings in this office. 1 month later, the president said, Prime Minister called the professor, his wife, and he said he wants to increase the number of women parliament members and invited professor to become the parliament member in the next elections. Woman parliament member. We said, oh, this is great, etc. We were five people in the room. And 3 months later, elections happened, and this woman, the professor, his wife, became the parliament member from Istanbul. Then 3 or 4 months, then 1 month later, the new cabinet announced, professor is the economy minister of Turkey. 6 months passed, president of Turkey died, and prime minister became the president, and economy minister became the prime minister. So, in 9 months of time, I became one of the closest persons to the husband of the prime minister. And this all happened after I saw an article at the library. Isn't it? Because I didn't have anybody from the business industry. I didn't have any networking in the. I was just a student. I took the, the magazine. I read article, sent a fax message. He came. I went. Franchise association. He called. And I am now in the board of the prime minister. So, why I am telling this? Because generally, young generations are not believing something will happen without any networking, without money. This is not the case. If you have a really correct business idea, then it is happening. if you can drive well, if you can drive the next steps well, because don't forget, the journalist asked me what is the next step. I gave a correct answer. Turkish Franchise Association. If I wouldn't give this correct answer, then everything would stop there, isn't it? So then the businessman called me, I organized a meeting. If I wouldn't organize this meeting, and if I would say, hey, I will do it, then you join, because you can think that they can take you out of the game, naturally. You can think, because you are a student. And they can say, okay, thank you. Now we will go ahead. That could be, I took this risk. I said they cannot find better than me, because I was trusting myself. So such kind of, if you bring the steps together in a correct way, in a correct timing, you don't need money. You don't need anybody in the world. You don't need any. You only need yourself. That's enough. And you can do it, because it is happening. This is how all happened in my life until now. You see, I am the president of the World Business Angels Investment Forum. In 2010, I was in Washington, D.C. Obama invited me. Obama wanted to make a personal meeting with me. And I didn't believe when the consulate called me. I was thinking, my friend, one of them, because I love making jokes, and one of my friends is making a joke, calling me, hey, we are calling from the American embassy and Obama wants to meet with you. And I said to this guy calling me, okay, I am busy now, so please, I will call him back. And then this is how I... But the next day, again, she called. I think you are not taking this seriously, but we have a mail from the White House, and we will forward it to you. Give us an email. I gave the email, mail came, and I saw, yeah, they are not joking. This is something serious. This is how it happened. By the way, maybe you saw Off the Bus into a Supercar, the book. This is what I all told in the book too. So in 2010, when I make this visit to Washington, D.C., CNN International and Bloomberg TV in D.C. wanted to make an interview with me. And in the interview in the Bloomberg TV, they asked me about angel investment. How is the angel investment in Turkey? I said, what is this? What angel investment? Then, of course, it was a live program and it passed. And after this interview, I immediately Googled, what is this angel investment, angel investor, etc. Oh, this is something very popular in the world. And I didn't know what, and like franchising, I didn't know what franchising is. Now another issue to follow, I said by myself. Then I came back to Turkey. 1 year later, Sony Pictures Television sent a message. Because Obama made this meeting with me, I became very popular. The president of the United States met with a Turkish entrepreneur at the White House, and it was this guy. So all media, we were making interview, etc. What did you talk? How did you talk? Was he long? You were shorter than him? What is the many the relevant, irrelevant questions? Then this Sony Pictures said in the mail, they want to make the Dragon's Den program on TV. You know Dragon's Den? Shark's Tank, Dragon's Den. And they are inviting me as one of the dragons of this show program. I was watching this Dragon's Den on BBC, and I never dreamed that I would be one of the dragons, because I was watching and I loved how the program was running. So I became one of the dragons at the Dragon's Den, and I became celebrity in Turkey. the second wave of celebration after this Obama issue came as Dragon. But in addition to this celebration issue, I became an angel investor. Because dragons are angels, startups are making pitching to them, and we were investing. That was angel investment. This is what I learned by doing in 2011. However, I had heard this question 1 year before in Washington, D.C. I collected all the books about angel investment and I started searching what about. Then I understood that there was a great demand in Turkey for angel investment issue, and I got in contact with the Deputy Prime Minister. And we immediately brought this angel investment to the agenda of the government in a very short period of time, and in 6 months of time, angel investment law came to Turkey with a 75% tax break for anyone investing in the startups and entrepreneurs. So, because I made it in a very short period of time in Turkey, I launched the Turkish Business Angels Association. I invited any potential angel investors around. They immediately established around 10 different angel networks, and we made the Turkish Business Angels Association. And as the president of TBAA, I was elected as the vice president of EBAN, the European Trade Association for Business Angels in Brussels. And this is my seventh year, and on 24th of November, the day after, I'm flying to Brussels for the annual congress of EBAN. And this will be my 14th annual congress at EBAN, because every year we are making two congresses. So after that, in Washington, D.C., I was invited to become the co-president of the Global Business Angel Network. So now, and then I was the founder of the Middle East Business Angel Network Trade Association. And then I was the founder of the African Business Angel Network. So I saw that in the world, not only in Turkey, not only in Europe, in the world, there is a big gap to synchronize the angel investment movement, because 340,000 people are investors in the States, 320,000 in Europe. There is a great demand from the public institutions to support this movement. Then I launched the World Business Angels Investment Forum, and immediately, in a very short period of time, we made the WBAF as the eighth global partner of G20 to advocate the importance of business angels. So what am I doing now? I didn't tell you, by the way, I told you all the stories about social responsibility, but in 1991, when after I launching this Turkish Franchise Association, it is now the one of the biggest associations of Turkey. In 1992, again staying at the dorm at the university, I visited the faculty dean, and I launched the first flight attendance course for airlines in Turkey, and I established a training institution in Turkey. So the name of my book is Off the Bus into a Supercar, but the original name is Off the Bus into a BMW, because 12 months later, I was staying at the dorm, but my BMW was waiting for me in the garden. Secretary General of the university invited me and say, please leave the dorm, because you have BMW and staying in the government's dorm and keeping, please go and rent a flat for yourself. This is how I left the dorm. And I came to the university in 1987, but left in 1997, 10 years. I studied 10 years at the university because I wanted to learn everything. Yes, I was very passionate about learning, so I wanted to spend my 10 years. No, this is not the case. Because I made an agreement with the university, I was using on Saturdays and Sundays the classrooms of the university because I didn't have money to make the trainings. And I didn't have money to hire instructors, lecturers, teachers. So I was hiring the university's lecturers, university's rooms, but I was giving advertisement and collecting and giving 10% to the university for this. So the first year, I made $5 million revenue in the first year. So now the Dölcom International is the name of the company, and everybody is asking me what it means in Turkey, because it is not a Turkish name, Dölcom. Dölcom means when I was in Wiesbaden as the guest of the German Franchise Association, this company I established became a very revolutionary idea in Turkey, because until that time, when you said course, it means language course or computer course in 1990s. I was saying, okay, but we can also organize courses for flight attendants. We can also organize courses for tour operators, for ticketing staff, for public relations, for human resources management, etc. Many courses, vocational courses. This was an innovation for the Turkish educational industry. And so I made $5 million in 1 year. Now it is not possible to make it, I know. Because now the market is quite different. Everybody is able to reach anything they need online, offline, etc. But in 1992, that was not the case. So I established in a short period of time 12 schools in Turkey, in different cities, including North Cyprus, and I converted the system to a franchise system. And in 2007, I made an FPO, the franchise public offering in Turkey, and I licensed each school to independent entrepreneurs by charging them a franchise fee, because I know, I learned the franchise system very well. So I converted the business model to a franchise business model. So now Dölcom International is one of the biggest schools, brand in Turkey. So the name of the book is Off the Bus into a Supercar. It is not a story. It is a real life story, how I made it as a student entrepreneur. What I want you not to forget when you leave this room is one thing. Powerful business idea, correct steps. If you bring them together, success is very close to you. This is what I experienced many times, not only Turkish Franchise Association, also Dölcom International, also Turkish Business Angels Association, also WBA Business School. The same system. Please don't look at the door. You don't have money, you don't have network, you are not politician, you're... But it is happening. So please, please don't close the doors to your destiny. Try to open the doors to your destiny. If you open these doors, then you will see many things are happening. I don't know what will happen. I didn't know what would happen in my life too. If you ask me, is that something that you dreamed to become the president of the World Business Angels? Or, no, that was not in my agenda. It was not in my agenda too, to meet with Obama. But when you make something right, however, invitations are starting. And if you can convert the next steps to good business models, then it works. That's all. So let's now stop here and give the floor to you. If you have any questions, I answer. Otherwise, I will go to the angel investment part.
All right, thank you, Mr. Altun, for coming all the way to Dhaka and sharing your amazing journey with all of us. I was just wondering, back in 1991, you were just a kid, or, you know, a student. Maybe you weren't even wearing a suit, or you didn't even have your own car. But you made such a bold step to meet a foreigner who doesn't even speak your own language. What kind of, what kind of mindset did you have at that moment to go forward and say, no, I am the guy that can get this done?
You can even invite Donald Trump to your country. And if he accepts, he comes. If he doesn't accept, it is his problem. It is not my problem. Because I have I have nothing to lose. I think this is my, but now I must be very careful. Because I have something to lose. Because if he doesn't accept my invitation, I should reconsider about my position, my prestigious, isn't it? I have to reconsider. But if I am a student, what am I going to lose? So simple. As a matter of fact, I am trying to keep this feeling still. Because I know the advantage of this feeling, of this psychology. I know it. It is very advantageous. Because it is opening the doors. I know. So if I would consider the prestigious issues, etc., maybe I wouldn't invite the German Franchise Association president. Maybe the other 19,000 people who read the article considered about this and they didn't kick the ball. Because if it is not goal, people say, hey, he doesn't know how to play football. But even people tell me, hey, you don't know how to play football. Yes, I don't know. I agree. I don't know how to make it. So this is important, and I'm trying to keep this feeling still while giving decisions.
I have a question for you that why do you think, did you think your student life, like first year student when you was, so did you think you do something different as like a student? So more of the student don't think about that time you when you were a student. So in our country, people, students do something different in their way. So that's just think they don't have platform, don't have much money. So in your time, what is the mind, your ambition, and your, like when you got some position, so how did you manage your career and everything?
My father was a general in the army. He was retired. So he's an army person. My mother was my teacher at the school, elementary school teacher. My father had, they were 7 brothers. There is no one in the business. They are all government bureaucrats. My 6 brothers of my, they are also government bureaucrats, doctors, nobody in the business area. So they were really upset, very upset with what I was doing as a university student. They were upset when I understood, I penciled the Faculty of Education because they were dreaming me as a doctor or engineer. Because it was the circle they were living. That this is the circle. And they didn't know even the meaning of management. Business administration. They didn't, by the way, tell me that there was such kind of departments because even in the school, because I was intelligent. I was not hardworking. Only maths was my good lesson. And I was in the maths Olympic Games of Cuba represent in the Turkish team, five students representing Turkey in the I loved maths very much. Still, I am solving questions of high school, integral questions, etc. I love it. But that's all. I hate physics. I hate chemistry. My physics, chemistry teachers hated me because the school director was asking them to pass me from these lessons because I'm representing the school Turkey in the Olympic Games and it will be a disaster if I fail in this. Because I was not studying. I never did anything I didn't love. I didn't. So my father and mother couldn't also convince me to become a doctor or engineer. I wanted to work in the tourism industry. That was my goal because I saw that people were making good money. How I saw, this is important. I was looking like other people, but one moment I saw it. One day after the high school, I had a girlfriend, but the girl friendship is different. We were just walking on the in night in that 30 years ago. Then I was taking her to her home. She was in the afternoon sessions. I was in the morning. There were two different sessions in the school. Around 6 p.m., the afternoon sessions ending, I was going to school, taking her to her home. And on the way, there was a carpet store. And the guy was trying to sell carpet to tourists, to German tourists. Because he didn't speak English, he was not able to. We were walking. Then I left her, and then while coming back, still trying to sell, I said, can I help you? I can translate if you like. He said, come here. Please tell this price, this is silk made, etc. I just made the translation. And he said, they went. Why don't you come here after the school every day until 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. And if you work here like this as a translator, we will give you 10% if a carpet is sold. 10% will be yours. The next day, I said to my girlfriend, sorry. You can go ahead by yourself. You know the way. this is the friendship of entrepreneurs, as you see. And I went to the carpet store. Two tourists came. Euro, you know Euro, but Euro in 1987 there was no Euro. It was Mark, Deutsche Mark, German Mark. 25,000 Mark. We sold the carpet the next night, and he gave 2,500 mark, which is 2,500 euro, cash the next night to me. I couldn't believe my eyes. Because with my weekly pocket money, I could buy only one Coca-Cola, one toast every week. Not every day, every week. That was it was 1 euro or 2 euro, my weekly pocket, because there was no expense. We were very close to the school, walking distance, etc. And when I saw 2,500 mark in my pocket, I couldn't sleep two nights. Yes, and I understood, I saw an important detail. What I saw, my mother, as a teacher for many years, is able to make 800 euro per month, but I made in 2 hours 2,500 euro. She had to work 3 months to make what I made in 2 hours. This is what I saw. Then I completely changed my mindset. The way my father, my family was proposing would take me to 800 euro. Maybe 801 euro, better than them. But I saw that what is proposed is not the correct way for me. And I created another route map for myself. This became a real problem in the family. As a matter of fact, many years passed, 1987, 97, 7, 7, so 32 years. 32 years passed, still this problem goes ahead in the family because they said something different, a completely different things happened, and I'm the architect of this roadmap. They are not able to still believe how it happened, because this is a completely different life in their circle. They couldn't understand how it happened and how it happens. I think the important thing is to know the personality of the people. For example, I have two daughters. My first daughter is not compatible with entrepreneur. I see. She is not compatible. She is not creative. But she is very hardworking. She graduated as the best third student of the grade. So I proposed her another route map. The route map that my father and mother proposed to me. I said, follow that way. Not these entrepreneurship issues, because here you may not. But the good thing is, she agreed with me. When she agrees with you, it is good. If she doesn't agree, it is also good. Because generally, people know their own capacity much better than others. They know their own capacity much better than others. This is how we perceive, or this is how we want to perceive. But the fact can be something different. So what happened? I asked her not to spend her time in the summertime by going to Grand Bazaar or trying to working in it. Don't spend your time with entrepreneurship issues. This is what I proposed to her. And you missed the beginning, so I cannot repeat again. So, and she made her intern at the London Stock Exchange in a professional area. This is what she did it. And then next summer, I said, don't go to travel agent again. Make an intern in a company. She made her intern at the Deloitte, the consulting company. And the last summer, she applied by herself because she learned how to make it. And she was accepted as an intern in Dubai at McLagan, another consulting company. And she graduated in June. In July, she started her, no, in August, she started her intern at McLagan in Dubai. And in October, they offered a job to her. And now she's working in a consulting company in Dubai as a business consultant. And she's very happy. For example, while she was working at the Deloitte, she was not happy. She said, Father, this financial consulting is not for me. I didn't enjoy. But here they are making HR consulting. She's very happy. She is making interviews, dealing with people, etc. And this is her way. But for the second one, the younger one, she is not hardworking. But while we are driving in Istanbul, she was 6 or 7 years old, and the lights were red. We stopped, and our office, Delcom International, was in the corner. And when she was 6 or 7 years old, her question was interesting. Hey, Father, why did you select the color of blue for the logo of Delcom? Maybe it was red, it was more attractive, and people see this is red, it is red, maybe it will be some. Now, this gave me an idea. She's creative. She's thinking. She's not accepting. She's questioning. She's questioning if there is a better way. Not like the other one. The other one, hardworking, never asked questions. Whatever given to her was accepted and implemented directly, without questioning. But she is questioning. So there are two different mindsets. So I am proposing her entrepreneurship. Start, look around you and see the opportunities and try to solve the problem and create a value. This is what she can do. I know I perceive the capacity, and she's happy with this. So I think you should ask yourself, what is your good? I mean, what you are good at, and focus on this. Otherwise, you will not be happy. If you want to become entrepreneur, then it is not enough to want it, isn't it? It is not enough. You should be compatible with the entrepreneurial mindset. You should have this skill, at least inborn skill, and then you can develop it in the Skills Development Institute. But you should have at least the core of the skill in your. So discover your own skill, because everybody has a skill. Everybody. Discover it and mindset, go ahead. That's all.
A few years back, I have completed my student life. Now I'm doing job. So my question is, suppose now I want to be an entrepreneur. I want to quit my job. So then I have started to looking for what type of attribute should be for entrepreneur. And I've started reading books and try to join seminars. Then, like you said already, try to find yourself. Try to find what are you good at. Try to find your passion. So, on your lecture, I've already gathered one thing, that you're passionate about learning. So, I have asked myself, what is my passion? And I found that it's like that I am passionate about my life. So, I want to be the master of all aspects of my life. I want to be a public speaker. I want to be a businessman. I want to be, I want to add value in my society. I want to be also good at my spirituality, because we have to die, we have another time. So all of the things are actually making me confused. So I have to quit my job. I am the elder son of my family. I have to take care of my family also. So I have to go for another struggling life, that is entrepreneurship. And while technology is going, artificial intelligence, IoT, Internet of Things, and my passion is a little bit different than this. So all the criteria is making me confused, actually. So I am requesting your kind advice on this.
Why do you want to become a speaker? Why? For example, I am asking the question to myself, why I wanted to become an entrepreneur? Why? Isn't it? This is an important question. Why I didn't want to become a doctor? But why I wanted to become an entrepreneur? Because I wanted to make money. Very simple. I wanted to make money. It was not my goal to make a business. My goal was to make money, because making business, making money are different things. You make a business, everybody shakes hands, you have the great business cards, etc., but you are losing money. This is not entrepreneurship. This is something different. Because you wanted to become a businessman, you want it, you made it, you are making a business, but you are not making money. So I think we should be clear about our first needs. What is your first need? And then match which of the things speaking, speaker, whatever you want to do is matching with to compensate this need. But you cannot focus on 10 needs at the same time. Choose the most important one for you. This is my advice. This is what I did. For me, the most important one in 1987 was money, because I didn't have it. It was very clear. As you see, I left my girlfriend because money was more important than me. I cannot focus on 2, 3, 4 different things at the same time, one by one. So this is my advice to you. Because everybody doesn't need money, by the way. You may not have money, but you may not need it. For example, when I was at the elementary school, My mother was my teacher. And I don't know if it is the case, but 24th of November in Turkey is Teacher's Day. Is it the case also here? No. In Turkey, it is 24th of November. Every year, we are celebrating Teacher's Day. And we were 60 students in the classroom. We were very crowded. Government school. And Serdar was the most hard-working student of the classroom. And my mother, I was calling her as teacher, of course, in the classroom, was appreciating very much the students who are bringing extra lesson material to the classroom. So everybody was carrying encyclopedia, the articles, etc. So they are going to get an extra score from the teacher. My father, as I told you, was an army person, interested in history very much. And I was 10 years old in 1980, and he took us to Anatolian Civilizations Museum, which was recently opened at the weekend. But it was a disaster trip for me because, you know, school children don't enjoy visiting the museums and seeing the stones, etc., etc. It is only stone. For us, it is not adding an extra value to small children. But however, on Sunday night, because on Monday it was our school day, and the lesson was about the Anatolian civilizations. Hattusash is the capital of Hittite civilization. This was the subject of the lesson on Monday. I took a small stone from the root. This is not ethic, by the way. I am telling you that. I'm not telling that these stories to you, do it like this. I'm just giving a 10 years old boy's mindset. I polished this stone and directly went to the client, Serdar, because he's the most hardworking student. Serdar, this is Hattusash stone. We were in Anatolian Civilizations Museum at the weekend, lying. Yes, that was the case, but the stone is not coming from there. And this is the stone of Datu, and it is 2.5 lira. He gave money, took the stone. My mother said, who is going to come to the stage and tell the subject? Serdar. Serdar came, told the subject, and dear friends and teacher, I want to show the Hattusash stone. My mother said, oh, this is great. How did you find it, Serdar? By bars. Selling 2.5 lira. He said, by bars is the son of the teacher. And I had to be a role model for other students too. And my mother said, how did you find it? Teacher, we visited the Anatolian Civilizations Museum at the weekend, and I brought it from there. But she knows this is not the case. Immediately, stone outside, and I was sent and money back to Serdar and out of the classroom. That was the highest. I mean, leave the classroom, don't come one day. That was the punishment, the highest punishment. So my entrepreneurship was appreciated with the teacher like this at the elementary school. But time passed. I'm coming to your question. Serdar passed the exams and became a student at the college. I was at the government school, and there was an English language course in our street. We were in the same classroom. And I said, Serdar, you are giving importance very much to English. And these 10 addresses, in my time, there was an international youth service providing pen friend addresses to people. And I received 10 addresses and sold them to 150 lira to Serdar. I wanted him to develop his English. That was my first goal. And he paid 150 lira. Time passed. At the university, we are in the same prep class. And he said he was studying at the construction engineering department. And he made double major because he also studied at the computer department at the same time. And he was playing guitar. And he said, Baybars, could you please import guitar for me? Because you have many clients at the travel agent, and in Bulgaria, guitars are very cheap. So I imported guitar for him. As you see, elementary school, secondary school, university, he's always my customer. Guitar, pen friend, or stone, or whatever. I am always sending an invoice to him, and he's paying the invoices. I'm the one who is always providing something for him. I became entrepreneur. He studied construction engineering, and he is now a very popular pop star in Turkey, not a construction engineer. He's playing guitar, he's everywhere, and he's very happy. This is what I mean. If you know what you are good at, and psychologically, there is no difference between him and me, I am happy, he is happy. But if you would push me to become a guitar player, I wouldn't be happy. If you push him to become an entrepreneur, no, he is not. He loves buying. He doesn't love selling. These are different things. He loves buying. You cannot push him to sell something. I never love buying. I don't buy. I understand what is what people need and provide it. If it is really a need, I buy it. If it is a need. So at home, for example, my daughters, my wife, whenever I come, the first thing I make, lights off. I don't enjoy, because if we don't need the light, it shouldn't. It is not a matter of money, wasting money, etc. It is not. But if we don't need it, we shouldn't.
Did you bring donar and dirhem for us from Turkey?
Do and don't.
No. Did you bring donar and dirhem from Turkey for us?
Dirhem, yeah. No, I didn't.
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, yeah.
The second question is, I was living in Germany for 6 years, in one in Stuttgart, and 5 years next to Düsseldorf. Mm. So I've met many Turkey people, we call it Turkish people.
Düsseldorf is very famous. Yes.
Yeah.
Mönchengladbach.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I saw most of the shoppers are from Turkey.
Turkish.
Yeah, because most of the travel agent or the vegetable shop.
Rice bureau.
They're everywhere. Even they sell international calling card to us.
Yes.
And so my question is it culturally normal in Turkey, or it is genetic for Turkish people to be businessmen?
Very good question. Turkish people, my personal view, this is what I am telling also in Turkey. Turkish people are not entrepreneurs. Now you will say, how these people coming from Turkey became entrepreneur and successful entrepreneurs? The most successful entrepreneurs in Germany are from Turkey. Why? Because these people immigrated to Germany 40, 50 years ago. Yeah. And they were like me. They had nothing to lose. Nothing to lose. This is the beginning of the story. When you have nothing to lose, you hire this shop. Because you have no money, if you sell, you pay. Otherwise, you don't pay. You own everything, as a matter of fact, when you have nothing to lose. Even the guy sends a notification to you, hey, pay it. I have nothing to pay. But after making it happen, then you are experiencing, giving an opportunity to yourself to discover the potential. And when you see the potential, it is becoming a big business. This is how it starts. So I understand you very well. These people were like me. They had nothing to lose and started by the way, the standards of living of these people were low. Yeah. So they were very ready to minimize the costs. Do you know that in Germany there was a research 10 years ago? People applied for the grant call of the government. 200 projects approved. 150 of them didn't come to the government and took money. They didn't. Why? Because when they took money and became entrepreneur, the government is donating, pushing them to become entrepreneur. Because the salary, unemployment salary, they are receiving from the government will be off. They saw the risk. They didn't get this money. It is better to get the unemployment. But if you wouldn't have this unemployment salary, take it. Because you have nothing to lose. And if it works, you go ahead. This is how it works. When you give opportunities to people, this stops them to create other opportunities. It is very important. So you asked me this question, but I would answer in a different way, but I forgot the answer.
The whole field explored, and I have a team working on it. But the thing is, how can I approach the investors? How do investors like to be approached? That's the main thing I want to know, because I'm still confused about that.
Yes. Okay. I will answer this question in the angel investment part. Okay.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I think we can start. Yes.
So, as you are part of different business from the very beginning of your life, how could you handle the risk factors of starting a new, for taking a new step? How could you manage the risk factors?
I have my own theory. If you Google, you will see it. Altuntaş Startup Compass Theory. The theory is, I have a different way of steps to take for entrepreneurship. This is what I am proposing. By the way, this theory is studied by Sheffield University. And they prepared a report because this is my claim. They made a research in 20 countries. Around 80% they say this is fine. The steps are, you are starting from entrepreneurship, coming to entrepreneurship, and then making innovation. These are the traditional steps, and then going. I am changing the places of entrepreneurship and innovation. First innovation, and then establishing the business. I'm changing the order. Why? Because I believe this century is not the century of entrepreneurs, as Obama said. He said, this century is the century of entrepreneurs. I don't agree with him. This century is the century of smart entrepreneurs. There is a big difference. Because population is different. Needs are different. Everything is changing now. So in order to succeed now today, you have to be smart. And smartness is coming from the business model, not from the business plan. Business plan is everybody can do it. Excel sheet, do it. Write your figures, assuming that investors will believe and they will forget it. Don't spend. When I established my business, I didn't have a business plan. But everything was in my mind. I had a business model. The business model was, because I didn't have money, I had to convince the university to give the classrooms free of charge to me with a success fee rate. This is what I had to do. If I wouldn't succeed convincing the rector, I wouldn't start that business. Because my business model is, I don't have money, I see the opportunity, I need classrooms, I have to convince the rector, Saturday, Sunday, the government, and it is the most prestigious university of Turkey, difficult to convince them because brand is very powerful, Bosphorus University, but I need this brand, because this brand is going to convince people to pay $5 million that year. I see it. So I convinced the rector, I don't have money, 10% to the university, because Saturday, Sunday, these classrooms are empty for the last 125 years. Since it was founded, this Saturday, Sunday, the doors are closed. So why don't we open the doors to people? I was lucky because the rector was from business administration department. And he understands the entrepreneurial mindset. And he said, okay. If he wouldn't say okay, most probably I will go to another university. I will not stop. Because there are hundreds of universities, then why need to stop? Because I was believing my business idea. So converting idle capacity. What is idle capacity? Unused capacity around you to business. That was my secret, let's say. This capacity network, the capacity, physical capacity, non-physical capacity, please see these potential and convert them to make business. That's all.
I have a question to you from your lifelong experience. What are the core values or entrepreneurial skills to have for an entrepreneur to be successful in his startup?
Three things. First, their eyes should be very good. Their eyes will see the door, not look at the door. Because when you see the door, you will see the opportunity there. Ah, this door is working slow. Then let's propose another door. Or let's bring, okay. Your innovative mindset starts thinking about it. The second, nose. The nose is very important. The nose of entrepreneur must know how to smell money. Of course. If you don't smell money, then it is, the third thing is ears. It should be very clean. Because you will see many negative things about your ideas. Many. From your mother, from your father, don't do it, it is risky. Who are you? Who are you? Are you the one to compete with this holding? You will, these words will come from here and leave in 1 second. So it should be very clean, your ears. So these three things. So if these are the main skills. Then, however, if you develop a good business model, it goes ahead. Either you ask for 200K, 300K, or ask 5 million. But if you say 5 million, don't come to startup competitions. Because angel investors will not put 5 million to you. Why? My last words. 1.2% of startups and entrepreneurs are able to reach angel investor money. 1.2%. So this means I have to listen to 100 different entrepreneurs and decide for one entrepreneur. One entrepreneur in every 10 entrepreneurs who reached angel money is able to create a success story. One entrepreneur in every 10 entrepreneurs. This means if I know these statistics, if I have 100K, I don't put it directly to one entrepreneur. I put it to 10 different entrepreneurs. But this entrepreneur needs 100K, not 10K, to scale up the business. This means I have to find other 9 people like me to compensate this 100K. This means I have to create a business angel network. So business angel networks are very important, and my tomorrow's speech at the university's summit will be to invite universities to launch, to establish their angel networks, and graduates will invest in the students of the university as an angel network. So I think these are the most important things of angel investment, and please pay attention while raising funds from investors. I know this is Juma, today is Juma, so some of you will go to Juma pray. So I am a traveler, so I can speak until morning, as you see, but I don't want to make it more, and giving the floor to Akhtar.
Thank you so much.
Mr. Baybars Altuntas, it's very difficult for me to pronounce your name. So, he is the guru of angel investment throughout the world. You already heard about the his history and all other things. So he's no more angel now. He is in front of us. We can see, touch, and everything. So he's not. Just I would like to congratulate and convey our gratitude to Mr. Vibers to come to Bangladesh, carrying the flag of World Business Angel Investment Forum. And special thanks to the organizers, especially the Department of Innovation and Entrepreneurship, and its head, Mr. Shibli Shariar, and then Beauty, as well as Asif. And a special thanks to the audience. And the today's audience is real audience, those who are going to be the really entrepreneur. And we are hopeful that from this session, you will learn something. And you will try to implement in your business journey, as well as encourage others as well for getting the angel investment. As per my personal opinion, the Bangladesh should be the most fertile land in the field of angel investment. It's not only the matter of businessman. I just want to become the angel investor. I am doing job, but still I have the opportunity to invest. If anybody of you want to get the fund from myself, if you can prove your idea is good, I personally will invest with you to start my, that is not the career. You will not only get the fund, you will also get the ideas as well as mentorship, guidance, etc. As the angel investors definition say, it's not only investing the money, you will also be getting the advices as well. So thank you so much once again, Vibers, and as well as the audience.
Thank you so much, sir. And that's the end of our session. Thank you very much for all participating in the session.